The image of motor racing, champagne all the way. But the reality is harsher. For Bradford's Russell Spence, the road to this year's victory rostrum started last November. To race in Formula 3, just one step from Grand Prix stardom, he had to raise money. A lot of it.
The cost is going to be approximately £120,000. So as you can see, you know, there's a lot of money involved, yes. Now, obviously, you know, I mean, on the things that I'm about to show you, you're going to make some decision either way, whether you want to do it or not, and how much you want to basically go in for. This is just basically a side view. If you took all the car, that's the sort of impression that you get of the car. The only thing that's governing the letters is in actual fact the amount of sponsorship. Yeah, you know what I mean? Right. So we can increase the letters for an increase of sponsorship.
The only thing really we're debating now is the cost.
And, well, we need to have a chat, don't we?
Yeah.
Can I leave you alone now and you three go through it? Then you can discuss it alone.
There is no sentiment in motor racing. In 1983, Russell won three championships, but without this sponsorship deal, he'll not even sit in a car this year.
It's that national coverage that does appeal, though. We have to make these days work up and down the country. Yeah. It gets us out, gets us there.
I'm sure you're right, Russell.
So there will
so you're
be
prepared to tell Russell £40,000?
Yeah. All right, well, let's call Russell back in now, and then we'll put him out of his misery.
Right then.
So.
Hi.
Yeah. Hello again, how are you?
What we thought was, as we couldn't sign you up as a salesman, we'll do it this way.
So what do you think about the package?
So the answers are yes, 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 we will go along with
that. That's great. Thank you very much.
That's good.
Thank you, Bruce. And this is the start of a good relationship then.
Well,
so now all we've got to do is get stuck in and get some work done. And the rest of the guys, it's getting worse. I think I'm getting old.
Yeah.
This is, I'll tell you what it is, I feel better than what I do when I win races after the decision you've made. Look at that. Not a drop spill.
The champagne soon lost its fizz. Before Christmas, his potential backers were out of business and Russell out on a limb. After much wheeling and dealing, he'd secured a drive with one of the top teams. But now he had no money and little time. By February, he'd just one chance left, a radiator company with stylish offices in the Yorkshire Dales and a flamboyant chairman to match.
I went to see Bill Bradford when, I mean, I was in the shit. There's no question of it. I think it was 3 weeks before the racing started. I've got £100,000 commitment. I've got £20,000 coming in and no future at all, basically. And as soon as I saw Bill Bradford, I don't know why, but I suddenly found myself thinking, that's where my future lies.
Obviously.
Yes, we've been looking at this as a proposition.
Yes.
And, obviously we're talking quite a lot of money. And it's very opportune that, you know, this proposition is coming over at this time. I feel that it's going to be, you know, very much to our advantage. Now, what I'm going to say to you is, because obviously, as a successful company, we look for a little bit of success. In principle, yes, you've got a deal. I'm a marketing man by profession, and many people have often said to me, what is marketing? It's a feeling. It's a feeling. And I've got a feeling that this one will come off. I think that using normal trade exhibitions and matters of this kind, media advertising, you're leaving too much to chance. I don't like to take chances, and I feel that this is possibly going to be the best way of getting to the people that we want to talk to. Because at each of these major races that we are sponsoring, we're going to have the opportunity of getting a couple of hundred people there. And if there are a couple of hundred people that we would like to be there, then the return on our investment is obviously going to be a little bit more of a positive gamble.
The thing that I found very, very hard to accept in motor racing is that no longer is it a sport. I mean, it's literally a multi-million dollar business. Now I'm 24 years old. Towards the end of this season, well, starting from now really, I've got to go out and sell to businessmen a $1 million package if I want to go into Formula One. And I think that's a lot of responsibility for a young man of 24. You know, the commercial aspect of it is where 90% of the pressure actually does come onto a racing driver.
And the pressure doesn't stop once you have found a sponsor. For the next 6 months, Russell will spend as much time at PR functions like this as on the track.
Lord Mayor, Lady Mayoress, ladies and gentlemen, may I take this opportunity of welcoming you to the offices of Warmastyle and to take this opportunity of presenting to you our recent, or our latest venture. If you'd like to look out of the windows, ladies and gentlemen, you will see coming towards you a noisy little beast driven by a gentleman called Russell Spence. Ladies and gentlemen. I think he's got great prospects. I'd like to be associated with his image. I would like his image to be associated with us, because we're an up-and-going, fast-moving organisation. We motor on, baby.
Cheers.
Thank you.
Cheers, everybody. Cheers.
All the very best.
All the very best. Cheers.
This time, the champagne was justified. By June, Russell was really being noticed. In his first year in Formula 3, he was second in the British Championship, ahead of much more experienced drivers, and with only one man, Johnny, Earl of Dumfries, in front. Now at Silverstone, he faced the big challenge to take on the best of Europe as well. Motorsport at this level is all about fractions of a second. For Russell and arch-rival Johnny Dumfries, minute adjustments make the difference to winning or not. Finding that final edge is time-consuming and often frustrating. Russell and team manager Glenn Waters are having their problems.
This race is different to our general races in England because it's a European race, and we have a choice of tyres here, which lends us into confusion, really. Our problem is that the weather's very, very hot, and the tyres that we have available are only marginally adequate. If we run too quickly on them, they blister and then puncture. So we have to strike a balance between running as quickly as we can, but not going too fast, and choosing the right tyres. In fact, what we end up with is four different tyre compounds on the car. Would you change anything?
No, the car's perfect, and tyres are letting us down, you know. There's no point in changing.
I mean, it's crazy to change something that's well balanced. What for? What am I going to change it to?
All we can do is twist their arm. You're second quickest anyway.
But fastest man Johnny Dumfries has the right tyres, and it's now crucial that Glenn can get them too.
They are probably the biggest performance factor of the car. Just by bolting a different set of tyres on, you can get more performance than by doing anything else.
Hi. Right. Just relaxing before the onslaught.
Overpressure them and let them down, or under pressure and let them go up?
I would under pressure and let them go up, but make sure he comes in after three laps and check them, make sure they're all right.
It's a normal procedure.
You have to bed them in here, it's a hard surgery on the left side. What about these fronts then?
Well, we've got to work on that for sure. I don't know what I'm going to do with that at the moment.
obviously the tyre companies have their contracted teams which they look after all the way through the championship, and I think that they generally take preference here. I mean, I'm not saying we're getting left in the cold, but obviously their contracted teams come first. Big business, I suppose.
Big money is never far away from motorsport. Every race costs Russell about £5,000. This car is worth a cool £30,000, and technically it's nearer Concorde than anything you'll see on the M1. After every test session and race, it's stripped down by the real heroes of the sport, the mechanics.
If Billy makes anything for my car, I know that thing is perfect. If Bobby bolts it on, I know that it's bolted on right. Throughout this year, we have not had one mechanical failure in 13 races, 10 in the British Formula 3 and 3 outside races, which is one hell of a record. Never one oil leak or anything. So that's the kind of commitment and kind of preparation that I've come to expect and that I demand from the lads. And by the same token, when I get into the car, I'll give them the same kind of commitment in a race.
And one particular corner at Silverstone, Stowe, shows just how total that commitment is.
Now, Stowe in a ground effect car, even though we've only got 160 brake horsepower, is a probably about 145, nearly 150 miles an hour corner. And all of a sudden, you see this grandstand growing and growing and growing and growing, and the corner seems to be getting sharper and sharper and sharper. And you suddenly start to think instantly, this is going to be a big one if we go off here. And then all of a sudden, it's gone.
Problems with the different tyre compounds A and D hadn't.
You're going too hard on them?
Yeah, let them cool off a bit. What
about the camera?
Take a little bit off.
Half a turn? Leave that up. Richard, check the backup, please.
What, the overheated one?
No, they're not overheated. What it is, you're going that hard on them this quick. They're just too hot.
Yeah, let's...
If you just let them cool down, they'll come back all right.
Yes, but that's stupid. What about the race?
Huh?
What about the race? I'm trying to get race from
them. What we're doing, we're knocking a bit of camera off it.
Great. Should we knock a little bit of this front wing off?
Let them cool off a bit.
Right.
Throw some water on them if you've got some. Yeah. Just cool them off a bit and leave them for a bit. Let them cure up a little bit more.
That isn't too hot, is it?
Water off.
Yeah.
That's enough. Get Derek, will you?
Glenn.
Hello, just a minute, Russell.
Gone.
It's all right. A bit more water and just turn
that's
it.
Gone. Take it off.
I can't take it off. You've got nothing else to run on.
I've got that here.
No, you ain't running on that.
Right, we went wrong.
Wait, yeah. Listen, just calm
I'm
down.
I'm not fucking going out with a tyre with an oil.
You ain't got the
hole
in it.
Well,
it's
all blistered.
Just calm down. Just please.
What times are we doing, Glenn?
24.5, it's a good time.
Who's quickest?
24.1 Burger.
What's he put on?
Another A. Hang on.
So we're putting as a D on?
We don't have any D's mounted. We've got to mount another one. We'll probably try it for tomorrow in a warm-up.
So shall I try this now?
That's what I'm saying. We try this. Right. Don't go too hard on it. If it shows any signs of getting a bit slidey at the back, come in.
Practice times decide the vital grid positions for the race. Russell hasn't long left to catch up with leader Johnny Dumfries.
We all work very, very closely. It's very frustrating when we're behind Johnny, whether it's 1/10 or 2/10 or 1/2 a second, because then it's either down to me or down to the car. And for sure we get onto each other, and for sure we push each other to extremes. And I think that's why we've been so successful this year.
He's a very aggressive driver. He's a driver that you have to restrain more than help along. You know, he's I wouldn't say he's headstrong to that extent, but he wants to get going as fast as possible, and I think the people that tomorrow go too fast will suffer. It's going to be a race that's won by a bloke who uses his head.
What? That'll live.
No chance. I won't drive with it. It's dangerous.
Well, better pack up then.
Sorry? Not at all. We've got off the path at the start.
Right, so where are we?
You go around clockwise.
As soon as I cut them side things out, I mean, you just, you know, understeer, oversteer, it burnt that tyre straight out. And, you know,
them last laps I couldn't even take club flat, which is no good at all, is it?
Well, we're lucky, we've got two left.
Two left. I mean, in racing, you get a lot of problems. I mean, there's a lot of self-doubt. I mean, if you're in a bad car and you're finishing fifth, you start to wonder whether it's you or the car. All the way through this, the family's never doubted me, which is a really special thing. And they've always supported me 100%, both financially and more. You know, everything I've always done, they've always backed me with.
Young men want to do stuff. You can't stop them. There's lads climbing mountains and everything. I think all you can do is support them and make it as safe as possible for them to do the thing they enjoy doing.
I'm always pleased when Russell does well, but I never can bring myself to sort of watch him. There again, I'd never stop him, and I'm just so pleased that he can do what he wants to do, because that's the main thing in life, really, doing what you want to do.
Now there is another Mrs. Spence, Nikki. How does she cope with the dangers of racing?
Obviously, Nikki worries a great deal about what I do. She's very aware that one day perhaps I'll go away and I won't come back. You know, it's as simple as that. But it's an attitude that we've both accepted, and we've both come to terms with that. It's a drawback of the profession that I'm in and the lifestyle that we lead.
It's something you just don't think about it. Well, I don't think about it. Every time he goes racing or goes testing, I just think, okay, he's going testing, I'll see him when he gets back. I try not to think of a time when I might not see him. You know, you just why think about it?
Even on race morning, Russell's thoughts are still not exclusively on the race. His immediate concern is the well-being of his sponsor's guests.
We've got a situation in this country where every young British driver sits back on his ass and cries, nobody will sponsor me. It's in the question. Nobody sponsors anybody for nothing. I've got to go out there and work for it. My job is to make sure that Bill Blanford's or any other sponsors have a good day out of the racing. In return, I'm climbing up that ladder.
I thought the banner was coming.
The day rapidly gathers momentum. Soon the crowd numbers thousands, but next for Russell is a lecture from Clerk of the Course, Pierre Aumonnier.
Gather around, please. I don't have to shout too loud. For those of you who don't understand English, I have an interpreter here who will interpret afterwards what I'm in fact saying. How's your Danish?
She's not here.
Oh, all right. Right, just a few things. Firstly, this procedure at the start, for those of you who are not used to...
For a few moments, this is just a sport, and may the best man win. But even the best man only gets as far as the starting grid by looking after his sponsors, and Russell knows this well. He is polite to everybody.
Hepworth draining systems as well.
Of course, yeah.
You don't know Ray Bass, do you?
Yes, no Ray.
Oh dear, I'm sorry about that.
For all the appearances, Russell is still short of money and courting potential sponsors. Are you now committed to it? So you've made the decision, have you?
Seriously thinking about it, I should think there's a 99.9% chance it'll come off.
What's left to be decided? I mean, what's the final?
Just crossing the T's and dotting the I's.
As often in business, it took some months to dot the I's, but ultimately the money did materialise. For the first time all day, Russell can concentrate purely on the race.
The actual racing side is a good part. I mean, that's the easy part. I mean, I'm in a cockpit with a helmet on, with my suit on. I'm in my own little world there. None of the outside world influences can really affect me. Then I'm in a situation where it's down to me and my ability, which I've gained over the years.
On the grid, nobility gets no privilege. Only a few yards of tarmac separate the Scots Earl from the Bradford Builder. By the end of lap one, Russell is up into third place. Then into second.
You have to look after his tyres, 11 laps to go.
Now Russell's really charging. The lap record keeps falling as he closes up on Johnny Dumfries.
It's a new lap record again.
Russell Spence now 123.95. His fastest lap 123.95, 125.73 miles per hour. So that's another new 4-3 lap record for the second place man.
But it's a back marker that decides the race. Russell has to slow down to pass, and Johnny gets away.
You were quicker than me with chicane and cubs.
Yeah, but you were good. You were great round here and great round at Beckett.
Oh, that was good.
Lap 14 to start the charge. I kept it there, just kept trying my tyres.
To some, Russell's problems seem minor. They finished well before the checkered flag.
Never mind. New lap record.
Yeah, it should have been our race, though, shouldn't it? You know?
I ain't done this in the arm. Excellent.
Sorry, lads.
All right, no problem. We're happy with it.
Whoa, 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 whoa. You're covered in champagne for the second time today.
To do as well as he's done in this company is excellent. These boys next year and the year after are going to be Formula One drivers.
Formula One for me is not a situation where I'd go out and I'd like to do it, or maybe it'd be nice if it came along. If I don't reach Formula One, then there's going to be a big part of my life missing somewhere. I mean, that is the direction that I've got to go in. There's no question of that.
The trimmings already seem to be there. But the car belongs to sponsors, and the idyllic home in the Dales is, for the moment, on loan.
All the trimmings, but unfortunately, personally, I suppose, by the end of this season, I'll be in a minus £15,000 situation at the bank. Having said that, I mean, if I make it in a Formula One and relatively successful, I mean, the £15,000 becomes, it becomes a drop in the ocean, really.
The return on the investment which we've made in meeting, contacting, communicating and motivating people has been precisely what we wanted. We have got just that.
I suspect you know an awful lot more about it than you did last year.
I do, considerably more. It's expensive.
But now we're going to jump from £150,000 to $1 million, which is a big jump. But, I mean, it's something that we've got to do. And somewhere out there, there's somebody waiting to give me $1 million. It's just a matter of finding it.
Thank you.